News that migrant detainees were undergoing forced sterilization procedures captured the nation's interest only for a few minutes. And of course, then they moved on. Right. It's you know, corporate media is such a, it's such a train wreck.
Well, you know, the president got sick, and oh my God, and there was a debate, and we miss the real stories that are happening.
Talk
in this
about
country.
This is a nauseating story. The only positive is at this point they don't have all the evidence on this case. If they do, this is a very, very ugly case.
Right. So basically, to take it back, I guess about a month or so ago. Whistleblower nurse who had worked at this detention facility, a woman by the name of Dawn Wooten, mm-hmm. came out and said, listen, there is evidence that says there is an abnormally large number of hysterectomies being performed on the women in this Georgia detention facility. Shortly after that, you had some of these women start coming forward and say, yes, I'm actually one of them. I had a hysterectomy. They didn't exactly tell me why it was happening, or they may have exaggerated the number of cysts that I had because a follow-up at another appointment said, no, this was not surgically necessary.
See, that's where the screw turns, you see. This doctor who they call the uterus collector. I mean, that's his name, the uterus collector. Well, he says, I did this because there was this large number of cysts, ovarian cysts that really concerned me. And I don't know how many women he saw, but right now there's at least 5 to 7 women that I've been able to calculate in these stories. Is that number sound about right?
Right. So far from what we know, that's how many there are. But this doctor has a bit of a troubled history. I was looking through it actually earlier today, trying to find more backstory on this man. Mm-hmm. And it turns out back in 2015, he got popped by the DOJ, a very, you know, easy slap on the wrist kind of pop.
Yeah.
But he had submitted, according to the DOJ, fraudulent claims under Medicaid and Medicare. And it was fraudulent billing. He was saying, oh, I performed this procedure, and this procedure. Turns out he didn't perform them. He was just doing it to get extra money. And that was 5 years ago that he was fined for it, activity going all the way back to 2013.
Yeah.
So this, to me, is one of those stories. Had they actually punished the man,
right.
he wouldn't have been around to do this.
It's always the same story.
It is.
They will not perp walk CEOs of corporations. They rarely perp walk doctors for this kind of thing. They slap them on the wrist and then they move on. But you see, that fits so perfectly into the story.
It does.
Obviously, if he's doing hysterectomy, the billable number on that is higher.
Yep.
He comes up with an x-ray to remove cysts. Well, you know, it's a fairly substantial number of involvement of cysts in those types of blockage possibilities that raise the need for surgery. And so the women that were looked at least a few of them, went back for a second opinion, said, did he really have to do that? And then, of course, Monday morning quarterbacking.
Right.
But the doctors say, no, he didn't. But if you look at this guy's history, you have to believe that you can't change the stripes on a zebra, you know?
Well, and I think to me, you know, that's a big part of this, too. This isn't necessarily the Trump administration is sterilizing people.
No,
you've got a real bad doctor who has a very serious and very real history of upbilling. And he found out, okay, I can't say I'm doing a procedure and not do it, so I'll just do the procedure. I think that's what this evolved into with the doctor.
Because it's more money.
Right. Well, I can't just say I did it. They're going to notice if this woman didn't have it. So let me just do it. I've done it 100 times. I know how to do it. It's fast. It's easy. I can bill it. More money for me. This is a migrant. Who cares? And that's the other part of it. They think, well, it's not a U.S. citizen.
Right.
It's not somebody who can go to a lawyer. They're here illegally.
But honestly, I don't see this as an ICE undertaking to get these people. That's where the story gets a little weird.
I think there's,
a
big disconnect between the two.
Yeah.
Right.
Unaccompanied minors are crossing the border at higher pace this year, leaving the Biden administration scrambling to rebuild whatever they've created in the last several months. I have Brigida Santos joining me now to talk about this story. Brigida, you know, it's that whole thing, you know, Biden comes into office and says Trump was awful. We have to agree with a lot of that. But the cameras, the reporting, what's happening on the border, it's not only the same thing, it almost looks worse. What's causing the surge of unaccompanied migrant children come to the U.S. besides Biden's invitation? What's happening down there?
Well, the current surge is partially due to the Biden administration's reversal of immigration policies that were set under the previous administration. Unaccompanied minors at the border are no longer expelled from the country as they were previously, and instead, they're processed at border facilities and transferred to shelters managed by Health and Human Services, which ultimately places children with a U.S. sponsor. Now, Homeland Security reports that in 80% of cases, the sponsor is a family member, and in half of those cases, that family member is a parent or legal guardian. So they're coming here to be with family. But the extra flow plus pandemic-related health and safety protocols are unfortunately slowing everything down. So Border Patrol facilities are now detaining children beyond the 72-hour legal limit, and we're starting to see photos of that emerging.
Yeah, well, how is the Department of Homeland Security dealing with this incredible increase of child migration? What are they doing that's different? If you follow this story, it almost sounds like their right to do much has been pulled back. What's happening as this story develops?
Well, DHS is scrambling. The number of migrant children detained at the southern U.S. border has tripled in 2 weeks. And despite the additional risks of the pandemic, shelters for migrant children have now been instructed to return to full capacity. The Pentagon has also approved a request to house migrant children at two military facilities in southern Texas. DHS is also reportedly setting up additional facilities in Arizona and Florida, and soon, child migrants may be held in facilities owned or operated by for-profit prison companies. Homeland Security and Immigration and Customs Enforcement have long outsourced the country's immigration detention system, so this is not something that would be outlandish. As of January 2020, 81% of people in ICE custody nationwide were held in facilities owned or operated by private prison corporations. Now, in January, President Biden did sign an executive order directing the Department of Justice not to renew contracts with private prison companies, but that order does not apply to other federal agencies like DHS or ICE. And according to The Intercept, at least three private companies have now posted job listings related to a child detention center in Florida that has a history of abuse. So this is very troubling.
Well, not only abuse, you see a lot of these prison companies. I mean, they've got a long history of failure. That's the problem. They're overcharging the government. They're understaffing people. They're not even complying with the basic parameters of what it should look like. And we continue to allow it anyway, and now they're just inviting more of them in? I mean, come on in and now take care of the children. What about the overall migration at the border? Is there an overall increase this year, or are those just figures that we're hearing from folks who have an interest in stopping migration?
Yeah, of course. We're not just seeing an increase in unaccompanied minors. We're seeing an overall surge in migration. The U.S. is now on track to encounter more migrants at the southwest border than it has in two decades. Some of the reasons for the overall surge include the seasonal influx, climate disasters like hurricanes in Latin America, the war on drugs, and U.S. trade policies that have advanced American corporate interests at the expense of civilians in Latin America. Problems at the border have existed for a very long time, and both political parties have failed completely to solve them.
Brigida, thank you for joining me. It sounds like it's something that Biden better get busy with. I don't know that sending Kamala Harris down there to take all the heat for this is the right thing to do, but we'll see as this develops. Thank you for joining me, okay?
Anytime, Mike.